Amen. Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Right now, you're in the College of Theology. We are the priesthood of this college. Amen.
Amen.
If you happen to know it, say amen.
Amen.
Come on, we could give a better one than that. If you happen to know it, say amen.
Amen.
It is my privilege to welcome you right now and the College of Theology. The name of the, I know I didn't have the those who are going to do the presentation, their name is going to be projected at the projector, and you could read their name up. But this evening, it is a privilege for me to introduce the person that's going to be bringing the Word of God this evening. He is our pastor, and he is the college dean. His name is Pastor Amurao. Are you happy to hear that our college team is going to be presenting
Amen.
A message today?
Amen.
You guys are supposed to be thrilled right now, right? But the most important thing, for all the teachers on the theology, if it's possible that you could encourage the other theologians or maybe few other members to come and join us and COT congregation, if that's possible, all professors of the theology who teach it to anyone, we could encourage maybe some of the other colleges, and also most of us, our COT theology students. But the most important thing, God is good. Come on now, I want to hear all the time, God is good?
All the time.
All the time?
God is good.
If God is good, turn to the person next to you, behind you, and say, God is good. And the person beside God to say all the time. I need to hear it up there, come on now. And this meeting we have here because we want God to continue to revive us. And there is no other place to be more than in the presence of God. And the road of Damascus, the road that calls straight. And you know God will meet you on the road of Damascus. May God bless you.
Good evening, everyone.
Good
evening. Before we start our celebration, let us pray first. Father in heaven, we praise you for allowing us tonight to be gathered together. This is a time by which our hearts will be united, O God, a time by which we ought or we desire to be closer to you. As tonight, Father, as we sing praises to you, may you allow your spirit to dwell in us and allow us to receive the message of comfort, a message of revival. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
For our first song, let's sing We Gather Together.
Pressing now.
next song, let's sing I Will See of Jesus.
Right. praise you and thank you, O Father, for your goodness, for your faithfulness, and for your mercy to each one of us. We praise you, Father, because you are a faithful God. And we thank you so much, Lord, for giving us this week of prayer to listen to your word. And especially, Father, I pray for your Holy Spirit to be with us as we worship you in spirit and in truth. And also, Father, I pray that as we listen to your servant, Pastor Amurao, may you hide him on the cross so that your righteousness alone be seen tonight. Forgive us, O Father, for all the sins that we have committed against you. All these things we ask in the loving name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you. I praise the Lord that we are gathered in this place to worship Him and to learn more about Jesus Christ. I have just arrived from the medical city. The doctor came almost 5 o'clock in the afternoon, and there are a lot of patients, and so you can just imagine the stress going back here to a UT meeting the appointment. So that's the reason why I just had my cell phone here that I'm going to use, where I can read the Word of God, where I'm going to read the Word of God from, particularly from the book of Mark, chapter 3, verses 13 up to 19. And actually, I'm reading from the Desire of Ages, chapter 13. The title of this chapter is He Ordained the 12. This is about the ordination, the calling and the ordination of the 12 disciples. And I read, "And he goeth up into a mountain, and calleth unto him whom he would, and they came unto him. And he ordained the 12, that they should be with him, and that he might send them, and that he might send them forth to preach the gospel." Let us pray. Father in heaven, once again, we ask for your guidance, and we ask for your enlightenment through your Holy Spirit. I pray, O Lord, that you will enlighten the minds of these young people, and you will touch their heart, that tonight they will be able to realize that sense of calling that you have given to each one of them. Thank you for the assurance that you will be with us. In Jesus' name, amen. So from this passage, we're able to learn that, number one, Jesus Christ is calling people. Number two, there are those whom Jesus Christ called to be his disciples, or to be his disciples. In other words, to be his followers. But the calling of the apostles, the 12, it was in a sense a higher calling, and with a purpose. The lower purpose actually is so that the disciples or the apostles could be with him, and later on for them to go and to be sent forth by Jesus Christ, and that is to preach the gospel. I will not elaborate so much on the passage, but tonight I would like to give a testimony, because I would like to ask each one of you this question: were you called by God? Tinawag pa talaga kayo ng Panginoon? Were you called by God into the ministry? And I would like to begin by saying that it is very important for each one of you that you understand, you feel, that you have the conviction, that you have the conviction that indeed you are called by God to become a minister. Without that sense of calling, without that sense of calling and conviction in your heart, I'm afraid what kind of minister you will be in the future. When I was working at South Central Luzon Conference, I have a colleague, and a co-pastor who is older than I am, mas matanda sa kaysa akin. One day, we were talking, and we had our conversation about the work, and even our personal experiences. I think he was already ordained in the ministry during that time. Do you know, I was surprised to what he said. Younger than he is, he confessed to me, do you know what? Until now, I am not sure if God really called me to the ministry. Though he was ordained and had been working in the field for quite a long time still, he was not certain, he was not sure if indeed he was called by God to the ministry. And I am not surprised that his attitude towards the leadership, and sometimes his attitude, his character towards his co-worker, I will not judge him. But sad to say, sometimes, okay, the character and the behavior that he is showing in our meeting and the way he treats others, nakakalungkot. As if he is not a minister. Why? Because many times he is being carried by his impulses. Mabibiglain siya, and because he is being carried by his impulses, the way he speaks, yung bang magagalit din. And when he is angry, sometimes he speaks words which should not be spoken by a servant of God. In our IBMPE handbook, in our International Board for Ministerial and Theological Education, IBMPE, there are three things that we need and that you need to develop while you are here in the College of Theology before going to that sense of calling. Number one actually is the development and the enhancement, the development of your character, attitude, character formation. Kumusta mga anak ang inyong karakter? How is your character? When, for example, in the midst of people and in the group of students, could they see in you that indeed you are a future minister? Higher than the highest human thought can reach is God's goal for His children. God-likeness, Christ-likeness is the goal to be achieved. Diba? We used to hear this. Pero, for example, if you are in a group, in dealing with your fellow students, in every situation that you are in, pinakabadal kaya ang mga ministro? Can we say that of all the students, the ministerial students, it is you who first and foremost is the one showing the most Christ-like character? I do not know. Are you going towards the direction? Do you have the purpose? And do you have the intention while you are here in the university? Trying to achieve and to attain that Christ-likeness above what is actually we can observe from the rest. Character. So, that's character. Number two, Then about character, we have many things that we can say about character. The show of love, the show of sacrifice, the show of humility, the show of the fruit of the Holy Spirit in our lives. Let's think about these things, young people. May mga ministro bang nag-cheating? I hope there's none. Be the best when it comes to character. Number two, sabi doon ay development of knowledge. Alright? Do the best and be the best of what you can in the development of your knowledge. We have our curriculum. They are actually designed to develop your ability mentally. And lastly, the last development is the development of your skills. Think about these three things: character, knowledge, and your skills. I was reading the call from the book Patriarchs or Prophets and Kings, the call of Elijah, and I was able to trace the development of Elijah on these three things: character, knowledge, and skills. That's why even he was working at the field, dealing with men, he was prepared by God to lead his people. But you know what? Before these things can be developed here in the university, again, I will go back to my position. You should have that conviction. You should have that conviction that God called you to the ministry. I believe, and I wrote this in my requirements before being certified by the IBMT as a teacher. Three things I hope I remember in my testimony, in my life history. Number one, when I became a Seventh-day Adventist, I was called by God. God called us to be His followers, believers. And I will not tell anymore on how God called me providentially. But I believe that becoming a Seventh-day Adventist, I'm not a born Adventist, I'm a converted Seventh-day Adventist. And I have that conviction that when I accepted Jesus Christ through baptism, I was called by God. Then, I was lucky that I became a member of a very active church, the one Seventh-day Adventist church. In fact, in that church, parang ito yata kaming ministro or ani. Have you known of the church that kind of church? Na lima o pito ang naging ministro. And I think meron doon mga ilang teachers. The one Seventh-day Adventist church. And so the church actually was so active that the elders used to train, and even the leaders of the church used to train the young people. Why am I telling this? I'm telling this so that you can teach your officers in the church someday to train our young people for service. There was the youth leader of the church. I think a month or several weeks after my baptism, The youth leader came to me and said, "July, Julio, this afternoon, you are going to offer," that was morning, "this afternoon in the AY program, you are going to offer the opening prayer." Wow! A newly baptized member, a young person, and I have a lot of stage fright. You see, I consider myself a very, intruder. Mahihiyain po ako. I was like that. In Tagalog, hindi makapisang ipon. I was a very shy boy. And yet here, in the church, here comes the leader of the church telling me, "This afternoon, you are going to offer the opening prayer." But that's not enough. That's not the end of what he said. He handed to me a piece of paper and he said, "You are going to pray. And here is what you are going to say." Nakasulat na. He has prepared the short and the appropriate opening prayer for the youth program. And then he said, "You can do anything to this prayer. You can memorize it. You can read it. You can change it. You can make it as a pattern. And you can make your own prayer." And that was the beginning of my participation in the programs of the church. Then comes next Sabbath. Again, he came to me and he said, "This time, you have experience participating in the pulpit. This time, I'm going to give you a bigger assignment. You will stand longer in front of the members of the church. Magbibigay ka ng Bible drill. You are going to live out in the Bible drill. And here is the Bible drill that you are going to share to the members of the church. This is how to do it." In other words, he calls me. It so happened that he was also the assistant superintendent of the Sabbath school. A few weeks later, he came to me and he said, "This time, you are going to participate not in the afternoon program, but you are going to participate in the morning program. The audience actually is bigger. We have a lot of members in the morning than in the afternoon. You are going to give the mission story." In other words, little by little, he coached me and he discipled me. Until I started to love participating in the church activities. And because of that, I took an active part in the programs, different programs of the church. And I also learned to preach, not only to take part in the Sabbath school. I learned how to teach, and I do not know. Perhaps not very scientific, but I was able to communicate message even during midweek. And I was also given the chance to speak in the hour of worship. And because of my active participation in the church activities, I was baptized April. When the election during the month of November comes, I was elected also in the Sabbath school department as superintendent and also associate in the youth department as a leader. Should I accept? Young people, I was called by God to a higher time, higher level of calling. From being just a member, now becoming an officer of the church. I consider it a calling. Right? Then later on, being a Sabbath school officer, we have an association of Sabbath school and youth in the district. I was also elected as an officer of the district. And I said to myself, this is a higher body. God prepared me in the church, and He is giving me a higher responsibility. Then one day, because by the help of God, having that sense of commitment in service, taking part in church activities, I participated in the district activities of visiting different churches midweek and Sabbath, even in my own expense. I just love to participate in God's work. One day, the president of the Layman's Association in the district came to me and said, would you like to study in PUC? Gusto mong mag-aral sa PUC? Would you like to take ministerial course in then Philippine Union College? And I said to myself, I don't like that idea. I'm afraid. I am afraid. But it came to my mind that God is calling me to the highest calling, and that is to be a minister of them. I was reluctant to accept the offer. Do you know what and why? I said to myself, if I will accept the offer, the whole district will be the one who will pay for my prison fee. And Pastor Pulina, I said to myself, mahirap pakibagayan at pakitunguhan ang mga batangin. Kaya mapatanggin nyo, but I know the culture. It's very hard to please them. And here I am, I will be supported not just by one church, one person, I will be supported by the whole district. And so how would I contact, how would I manage myself? Being observed, and I have the expectation of all the members of the district. And so I said to myself, I will not accept it. Will you please come and I will just show you something? Extend your hand to me like that, as if you are calling me. And I'm doing like this. Once again. Okay, thank you. I do not know if it was a dream, but it was just a result of my reflection. My contemplation that when I became a Seventh-day Adventist, I was called by God. When I became a leader of the church, I was called by God in a higher calling. And when I became a leader in the district, it was even a higher calling than before. And now Jesus Christ is calling me to the highest calling that He could ever give to humanity. Can I afford to do something like that to my Savior? He who gave everything to me. He who sacrificed His position, the splendor of heaven, the worship of the angels, and He extended His hand to me, calling me into the ministry. And because of that conviction, I said to myself, whatever it will take, though it's hard to please the Batanggenios, I will try to sacrifice just to accept the calling of my Savior and Lord. A decision in my life that I never regretted, young people. But the lesson that I would like to communicate, that I would like to leave into your mind this time is this. Do you have that conviction that indeed God called you to the ministry? I would like you to be glad and try to turn back the pages of your Christian experience. Can you point out in your past experience that somewhere, somehow, tinawag ka ng Panginoon para magpasko? And if you have not yet established the path, if you could not recall, then I challenge you, young people, I challenge you, my friend, pray to God that somehow He will give you, that somehow He will remind you, that somehow He will give you that conviction that once in your experience in Him, tinawag ka ng Panginoon para mag-ministro. You know what? This will affect the way you are even here, right now. Your character, the way you deal with your academic aspects. If you think that you are being trained and being developed, then you must acquire all the knowledge, all the skills necessary, because you have the conviction you are called by God. God bless you all.
Don't be afraid to leave our part, always trust Him.
In their heart will be established and will be becoming greater and stronger, and the sense of calling will be their direction and will be their guide to become the best of what they can in everything that they do, in their character, in their knowledge, and in their skills. O Lord, we pray that you will continue to speak to us and be with us in the remaining days of this week of prayer. As we separate from one another, give us your peace, give us your benediction. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Peace be with you.